nonprofit organization that teaches women to code. The girl part is a little bit misleading. But they teach women to code. And I moved to the Twin Cities in Minneapolis, Minnesota, let's see, about 5 years ago. And the first thing I did when I moved there is that I decided I wanted to get involved with the local tech scene. I lived in a small town before that in northern Minnesota. There was nothing up there. There was nobody to talk to, nobody to be able to collaborate with, and I worked alone. So in doing that, I found Girl Development, and they had a meetup group in Minneapolis, and they were teaching one of their first classes, which was like an introduction to HTML and CSS. And they had a call for TAs, and so I was like, hey, I can totally help, I can answer questions, whatever. So I went, and I TA'd, and the chapter leaders afterwards were like, you were amazing, can you please teach additional classes? And I was like, what? I've never thought about teaching classes, like I just wanted to come here and help people. And so after like, you know, a couple minutes of a conversation, I was like, sure, I will do this, like this sounds great. So I created additional curriculums that Girl Development wasn't offering. So we did a very CSS-focused class, we did a website concepts class that talked about like FTP and Git and like servers and all the things you need to know to get your website online. And then also taught a WordPress class, which was really exciting because I love WordPress. And it really kind of ignited this fire in me of the fact that I loved teaching people to code. We all know stuff, we know something. It might not be coding, it might not be, you know, CSS, whatever it is that you know, like someone else wants to know what you know, and why not share that with them? So that's where I got started. So a little bit more about me. They had mentioned like sponsors and speakers crossover. I'm that test case for sure. I'm a developer advocate at Pantheon. My background has been a developer for like, I would say over 10 years now. Started in Joomla, did some Drupal, did a lot of WordPress, still do a little Drupal. It's kind of a crossover between all of those CMSs. Again, instructor for Girl Development in Minneapolis. I am the founder of an organization called Outspoken Women. If you are a woman in tech and you want to get involved with public speaking, that's where you should definitely go. Also lead organizer for Camp Minneapolis this year. So this has some information about me. I'll have my slides available. I usually share them on Twitter, but if anyone else wants to get them other ways, just reach out to me. This is just some information about me. As you're watching the talk, if something really like hits home with you, I would love if you'd share it on social media. And then they have an official hashtag of WCSD. All right, so when I first thought about like building this talk, it really was because I feel very passionately about the fact that new developers who come out of code schools or who come out of college or any other type of education really struggle with getting their first job. And that's really what I wanted to like hit home with this talk, and then how we can really help to change a lot of those things. So some little stats here. So the job outlook, in 2016, there was 162,000 total jobs in development in general. And in 2026, it's expected to grow to 188,000 jobs. That's a really large increase, but the problem with that is that, yes, it's great, tech is growing, that's awesome, it's a good industry, but we're going to lose about 10% of our developers, that they're going to retire over the next 10 years. On average, developers actually tend to retire at about the age of like 55. So we lose those extra 10 or 15 years that other industries might still have different candidates in. So we've got this increase. We're also going to have this really large loss as well. So we really need to put a lot of focus on training new developers and bringing them into fields and teaching them things that we know. So for all of you who have a phone or who have a computer, if you go to sli.do on your phone or computer and you enter in the event code of WCSD18, this will come up again later, but I wanted to show you it now because there's going to be a couple questions on there that I'm going to ask you. I want to get you all involved. And then there's also an area for you to ask me questions. So at the end of this talk, it'll allow you to just put your questions in there, and then I can go through and answer them, and we can have a little bit more conversation about that. So I'll leave this up for just a minute or two while you guys kind of talk to me. Which also gives me time to get water because I have silly colds in my throat. might be answering the first question I had on there. All right, so we're going to move on. If you did miss this, I'll have this again later right before we do the questions. So some more information. In doing this, so I mentor a lot of new developers that come out of a coding school in Minneapolis. And in doing that, I, again, had just told you, like, I was very passionate about getting these people jobs because they can't find jobs. And so I started looking through job descriptions. Like, what does an actual junior web developer look like? What should they know? What kind of experience are people asking for? Like, where can I help them find these jobs for them to get started? And it was actually really heartbreaking. In my mind, if I see a junior web developer role, that means you don't know what you're doing, right? Junior to me is entry level. You've maybe learned some things so that you're qualified enough to be a web developer, but nothing that I would feel like would be quantitative experience. So going through that, in the junior web developer title, 60% of them required at least 2 years of experience. That blew my mind. Like, if you're a junior, you have 2 years of experience, people are going to snag you up. Like, anyone who's a developer that has 2+ years of experience is more than proficient to take a middle type of a role, in my opinion. Things change, and if you've been a developer for 2 years, you've been through all of the recent changes. You probably know React better than I do, because you know all of these new things that have been coming out. 18% of them required 1 year of experience. I think that's fair. If the other number wasn't so large, that would be okay. And only 22% of them required no actual experience, which is ridiculous in my mind. If you're coming out of a code school and you don't feel 100% comfortable with the things that you've learned, sure, you've learned them, you've passed your tests, you've gotten through, you've graduated, like, how can you feel comfortable applying for a job that requires experience? I personally wouldn't, and I think that I would feel defeated. I wouldn't know how to move forward from that. So here's kind of an example job description that I found. I stripped out all of the company information and just keep it very neutral. The things that they want people to know, like the distributed version control within a team. It took me like a year to feel super comfortable with Git in a team environment where I have merge conflicts and other issues, but I can resolve those. That's a huge thing. It's a huge hurdle to get over. They want you to be like, to know the emphasis of designs, but they also want you to know the latest JavaScript frameworks. They're basically, they're asking for someone who's been in the industry for multiple years, but they want to pay you $40,000 a year. It's just not fair. So how in the world are they getting this experience? How are they learning these things? They're not, and that's the problem. This is my hug. So for me, I want to be the change that I wish to see. So be the change that you wish to see in the world. So let's all change that. We can all do things to help mentor them, help get them more comfortable. Also help them read job descriptions, like read between the lines. If you've got some of it, but not the other ones, encourage them to be able to move forward and still do these things and still apply. So I break this topic into two sections. The first section is if you are in an organization, if you own a company, if you're a manager, if you work in a company and want your company to get involved, it's going to be some tips for that organization on how to kind of get started. And the second half is if you're just an employee, if you're a developer, whatever you are, it's going to be more tips about how you personally can get involved and get started in mentorship. So this first section will talk about organizations. And then we're going to chat about why you should hire junior developers. Team morale. So mentoring is rewarding and good for team morale. If someone teaches someone something else, the person who learned it feels accomplished, and the person who taught it feels like, wow, like I totally just did something good. And I didn't even realize how good it was, but now I'm feeling it. And that just makes your team all around just happier and feeling more accomplished, which is really important. Finding good people is hard. It is a lot easier to find someone who matches your company culture and maybe a personality type that you are looking for, and then teach them the skills, rather than try to find someone who matches all of that plus has the skills. You're going to be hiring for months, maybe even years, if you're looking for a really expertise type of a situation. So just hire good people and give them the skills that they need to be successful in your company. Passion is infectious, so this is also like the team morale one. As you can tell right now, I am very passionate about this, and I know that like the rest of you are feeling this. And I've been there. I have watched other speakers that are super passionate about something. And then I personally am like, oh, works the same way in your team. If you have someone who comes in and they're super passionate and they're really excited to teach someone, or maybe they're really excited to learn. Junior developers are probably one of the most passionate people I've seen in my life. They have gone through schooling, or they've decided this is something they want to do, and they just want to learn. They're a sponge. They are ready to soak up everything, and they're happy to do so. And that's going to rub off on everyone else that they're around. New ideas and thinking. If we have all been in a team, I'm sure all of you have felt it. I was on a team for a while. We were like working on the same type of projects for like 2 years. We just kind of had the same flow. None of us are really changing anything different except for like maybe industry standards, coming up with some updates, things like that. But really had no new ideas. We brought in a new employee, and even though this new employee wasn't a junior developer, there's still someone new from the outside world, and he had different ideas and different visions. Bringing in junior developers is going to be completely different than that. It's going to be even more accelerated than that. They're going to come in and not have a lot of industry expertise, so they're going to have information or things that they've seen from the outside. So they're going to be very comparable to maybe your end clients or other users, but have some awesome knowledge about what you're trying to accomplish. So they're a very good person to come in and be able to give you some new insight on processes and procedures. All right, so we heard some reasons as why. Let's talk about how you can get started. I'm going to take a sip of water first. All right, so I feel like I've already really put the pressure on job description. But as a company, you are the one responsible for those job descriptions, making sure that they actually list the things that you want in that future employee. Has anyone seen a job description? And maybe if you know dev stuff, you will understand this, but a job description where it says, we're looking for HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and Java. Has anyone seen that before? Yeah, so the laughing point, if you're unaware, is that Java is completely different than JavaScript. Java is a back-end coding language that requires more complicated setup than just running in the browser. And so when I see those job descriptions, it just makes me laugh. Like, who's writing these? Where are they getting this information? So when you create a job description, have the people that are going to work with this person review that. Allow them to contribute to what you really actually need as a team. And also, if you're willing to hire junior developers, don't put 2+ years of experience on there. You're going to just allow them to feel defeated. Put on there that you're looking for someone passionate and willing to learn. And don't even put experience. Or maybe put some of the coding things. We want you to have dabbled in this. We feel passionate about you having these subsets of personality skills. Whatever is important to you, make sure that you write it so that they feel welcomed and that they want to apply and feel like they are qualified to apply for that job. Create strategic partnerships. Partner experienced developers with new developers that share goals and coding interests. So if you have a smaller company, you're obviously just going to pair people together that it makes sense. But if you have a larger company, find people that maybe have some type of shared interest. Maybe there's people that both like to go blacking or that both love dogs. I love dogs so much that if I find someone else who loves a dog, then I'm like, oh, you're my new best friend. Like, find a way for them to relate to each other and have that partnership so that they want to talk to them, so that they become friends and it's